This is Guardian Radio, your station for up-to-the-minute news, intelligent, interactive, and engaging conversation. 96.9 FM. The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
I come in to collect everything that you owe me. Good morning, it is CA Newry, and once again, this is History Friday. Today, we're talking about Bahamians, actually. Bahamians pre-1973. Not just ordinary Bahamians, like historical figures, but historical figures that has made a global impact. People we forget. People we don't remember. People we just don't know. But these are no ordinary people, you know. These people are so large that the entire world celebrates them. But just that we just don't know as Bahamians. The other day I was having a conversation. It was basically about the idealism masterclass that the honorable men had the other day. And they were talking about 1973 and the movement of Bahamians and the great things that Bahamians were doing. And I'm saying, but the Bahamas is an old place. The Bahamas is an old place with an old history, an old story that can make money, that should be celebrated. My guest today is a historian. Part of who he is, he celebrates first himself, celebrates his blackness, celebrates Africa, then celebrates the Bahamas and the story, telling a different story. Instead of saying his story, he tells our story. And I commend him for that. And mind you, we tend to row a lot because I said some of his story is important to me, right? But today, I'm starting a conversation on Joseph Robert Love. A few Bahamians know him. I've been inundated with some texts the other day and saying, Newry, can you find a historian to talk about Dr. Love? And I said, I told everybody know who Dr. Love is. And the text me back again. Three different texts to know you don't understand. He is of global significance and a Bahamian. He may be the most significant Bahamian in the history of the Bahamas. And I said, man, he can't be no more significant than Lyndon. Lyndon's the most significant person we have. And he said, no, man, you don't understand who Dr. Love is. So I said, okay, I should bring in a historian to speak about Dr. Love. And we can analyze that in a Bahamian context. And perhaps someone could be listening. That, again, my guest, I forget, I didn't say his name right, Christopher Davis. What is your new title name now? Forgive me.
Nana Safahini John Kwao II, simply put, John Canoe II.
I like Christopher Davis, you know. I know you too like that. I like Chris. I brought him on to challenge him, right? Because I know Dr. Love, but he knows Dr. Love more because this is what he does, especially during his Pan-African work, right? So these type of conversations is important to him. So therefore, it's important to me and important to the Bahamian narrative. I'm saying that we have an African-American market out there who is craving to come to places where they can connect to. But they don't know about the Bahamas. They don't know how significant the Bahamas is to their idealism of who they are. And that's what we're talking about. How global. Good morning, Chris. How are you doing today?
I'm wonderful. Seeing. Thanks for having me on. As usual.
I appreciate the director for allowing you to come because I always got to call and say, hey, your boy available? Because I don't want to pull him and you're all sad complaining that he always here, right? So I always ask first. And I say, yeah, man, call him. So it's good. Robert Love. Mm-hmm. What you know about Robert Love?
Just a little bit, you know, but I think that everybody should at least know who he is. And in my opinion, he is one who should be ingrained in the psyche of all and can be a profound example for many of our civic leaders today. Because, you know, he was a unique character in being an Anglican clergyman, but at the same time, a staunch and unapologetic Pan-African.
You would
even before the term existed, if you will.
You would go as far as saying that we should have a bust, a statue of a Dr. Love someplace in the Bahamas where people can go as a pilgrimage and pay tribute?
Well, incoming ambassador to Ghana, Mr. Andrew Wilson, actually pretty much seconded a bust of Joseph Robert Love, and that was essentially one of the only major commemorations of the man. But he was actually born in 1839, 1 year after slavery, and it's almost like the ancestors sent him to us.
Mm-hmm.
You know, 1839, right in the St. Agnes area. He was actually christened in the St. Agnes Church, and that is where he spent his entire childhood until I believe he was in his late teens or early 20s, and then he moved to the United States.
Let's pause there. People need to appreciate that 1 year after, what do you call it, the 4 years...
They would call it the apprenticeship
period. The apprenticeship period, right. After slavery.
Mm-hmm.
So we had the culture of slavery's black people at this time. And this Dr. Love, Robert Love, was born in St. Agnes area.
Right.
And St. Agnes Church, right, even though they had white rectors, had a place for Africans who live into the community. And in fact, right, a number of Africans attended that church,
mm-hmm,
right? And Robert Love was one of those persons born in that era who got christened in that church.
Yes, and in my opinion, to be honest, he was a genius.
And a slave genius?
Well, he was never enslaved, but mm-hmm, his parents were.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm trying to pinpoint where that was, but it seems as if it was either in the Crooked Island, Long Key area, or possibly in the area that we now know today as Love Beach. So... But I don't want to dwell on that too much. He went to the United States, and he was not just a clergyman. He became a doctor, medical doctor.
You need to go into this narrative quickly.
Yeah, right. He went to, I mean, he was just all over the place. He probably had about 8 titles and all sorts of letters behind his name. But what he was before anything, mm-hmm, was a Pan-Africanist. Okay?
Explain that first. What you mean that he's a Pan-Africanist?
Even though the term didn't exist then, this is a term that actually is the end of the 1800s going into the early 1900s. Pan-Africanist simply means all African. Someone, and it's actually a much more broader term than people often give it credit for. So anything that is quote-unquote pro-black, you can also identify as Pan-Africanist to a certain extent. But it's the idea, and the political ideal is a political ideal that believes that, you know, we all share a past, we share a present, and we also share a destiny. And now we should move to work together economically, socially, culturally, and connect with the entire African diaspora and see ourselves as family. This is actually a brand new concept. And it's important to note that this is something that was actually unprecedented among African people. Right, not to digress a bit, and this is what causes all of that misinformation when we're talking about the transatlantic slave trade, right? So you have people say, well, them black people enslave other black people, even though the term black didn't even exist.
Mm-hmm.
Pan-Africa is only bred out of that experience, but it was also bred out of the need for us to unite, and ironically, out of the categorization that was placed on us by the oppressor, by calling us black and putting all African people into one monolith, even though Nigeria alone is more diverse than the entirety of Europe.
But let's go back to Dr. Love.
Yeah.
Dr. Love emigrated from the Bahamas to the United States circa 1860-odd. Slavery was just about to over.
Right.
In the United States. He risked his life being captured again,
mm-hmm,
and went to New York as a black man.
Yep.
Right? And a free-thinking black man. Because
mm-hmm,
I know, part of our history, that we, the Bahamians, we call it Bahamians loosely, right?
Mm-hmm.
Who traveled on boats to the United States, had to petition our British government, saying every time they go to trade in the United States, they are subject of being captured and kidnapped and sold into slavery.
Yep.
Right?
Most definitely.
So Robert Love, knowing that they still had slavery, in quotes, existing in the United States.
Oh, yeah.
He sailed to New York, a free estate,
mm-hmm,
right?
Yeah.
To start love, I mean, start life there.
And then he also spent most of his time, I believe, in the United States in Buffalo. That is where he ended up, I think, getting his medical doctorate, I believe. But I know he spent a significant adulthood time over there in Buffalo, right? But and that's exactly, I'm happy you made that point because I was about to segue into that, you see? So this was a man who was fortunate enough to have enough space to breathe, right? So, because most of our ancestors were in utter, complete, perpetual survival mode, you know? And when you have that space to breathe, you don't have space to think. And this is why even slave revolts were typically led by the driver, the cart driver. You know, Nat Turner was the preacher, going around preaching to people. And so he was one who was able to think because he ain't only got to work and worry about dying if he disobey and all of this stuff, right? And so he was fortunate enough through his genius, I might add, through his merit now. So even though his fortune is still through his merit, to be able to do that. And that is what radicalized him. And then, of course, we know that later on in life, he moved to the Caribbean, and this is where...
I reached there yet.
I'm going to jump ahead.
I see you mentioned his genius.
Right.
In the Bahamas, we've had three Rhodes scholars so far.
Three.
Right? Okay. As Rowell, Campbell, and Cox.
Yeah.
They, in the world, it's ranking Dr. Love as smarter than all of them. This is the brilliance Dr. Love have. And again, I wonder why Dr. Love is not being celebrated, because the people said this African, this black man wasn't just smart, right? This black man who just gone to primary school here in the Bahamas,
right?
And went to United States, and by 1871 became a clergy in the Trinity Church in New York, right?
Right.
Then transferred to St. Stephen's Church in Savannah, Georgia,
right?
Was just brilliant. They said anything he put his hand to.
Exactly, that's what I was just
going to say.
So he was also a journalist, you know, but that's a little later when he moved to the Caribbean, but I don't want to jump ahead. But, you know, he was just a man of many trades, and he was brilliant at every single one of them. He should be seen as one of the fathers of Pan-Africanism, right alongside Martin Delaney and Edward Wilmot Blyden, who was many of his ancestors to this day reside in the Bahamas, including the Honorable Priest Blyden, who passed away recently, may he rest in power, right? Now, Joseph Robert Love, as we say, was a genius. So we have to get into this space as Bahamians where we almost deify our heroes, you understand?
Because he's irregular. Joseph Love is irregular.
Exactly. And his influence on Garvey and what Garvey became should tell you enough. I know, right? I just want to make this point, you know. Dr. Umar Johnson at this point, too. Farai has deified Marcus Garvey. Right? And when we're talking about our national heroes and we're talking about church, and when you look at how some of these saints become saints, it's laughable. Some of them become saints for killing African people and all. And we ain't know that, and we sainting this and sainting that. But that's for another day. However, why do we not deify our heroes? Why do they have Greek saints in the Greek Orthodox Church? Are you sure even if you go to Korea and you go to Korean church, are you sure they get one or two Korean saints? You understand? And it's like, we got to get our saints fed to us from the Europeans. So when the Catholic Church say, oh, yeah, then we accept that. Never mind the people who fought and died for us. But anyway, now, Joseph Robert Love then spent his time as a clergyman.
Yes,
right?
And he became the first rector, African or black rector.
Right.
Yeah. Right. In history.
In history, right.
See, we know how significant that is.
Right.
And it took us set of centuries before we had a black rector here in the Bahamas.
I so happy you say that, because, boy, I so sorry now. And this ain't throwing no shade on the Mins family. As a matter of fact, they have one of the most amazing stories. All of them are descended from a woman of royal Congolese descent who saved the life of a man named John Mins. It's a very complex story and all of that.
Right? Member of Parliament.
Right, do get it, right. Well, I think he became that later. He initially was an indentured servant. She saved his life, and then strong black woman, he used her, exploited her, however the story goes, and then, but anyway. But his time served as a clergyman, and that's what makes Robert Love so unique. Here you have this staunch, unapologetic, and then, like you said, now, he went the time he was functioning, chattel slavery was still going on in the United States, which is absolutely insane when you think about it. So I personally believe that that role that he played was just his way, was more of a political thing than a religious thing or a spiritual thing for me personally. I do believe he was a Christian. But I believe that he was not in his heart, an Anglican. Because the head of the Anglican church is who?
The king.
Okay. Chucky boy, as they call him. Mm-hmm. Right?
I want to transition now, because I see the calling. I want to go to the calling next, right? Mm-hmm. Love, Dr. Love, then migrated to Haiti. Yeah. What Dr. Love doing in Haiti?
Well, he went there. I believe this is when time he served as a journalist and a politician for a while in Haiti. But long story short, I want to get right into this, because this is where history is so interesting, particularly in the 1800s. You see many paradigm shifts as it relates to Bahamians and Haitians, or Haitians, whatever mm-hmm. you want to call it, right? Haiti being the proper original name.
The Awak name.
Right, exactly. Now, Joseph Robert Love went there, started to stir some things up. You know, Haiti at the time, though a black republic, by that time, France had almost recolonized Haiti, if you catch my drift, you know. Mm-hmm. And that is one of the big myths, to segue. People don't understand that after the revolution, Haiti was doing well for decades following that revolution. Mm-hmm. And then it was after France recouped, after they had to sell all their territories for almost all, except Quebec in North America, because of the Haitian Revolution, then everybody in the world gang up. The United States didn't even recognize Haiti until slavery ended. That was the only time it would have been safe for them to recognize Haiti, until slavery ended. Now, ironically, Joseph Robert Love, a Bahamian, went to Haiti and was considered too radical, and they kicked him out.
See, you, and I'm coming to you, caller, right now. We don't understand what you said just now. The Haitians taught, I mean, they had a big thing in Haiti. They said this Bahamian man come here and think he trying to take over.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
And they expelled him, saying he is the worst person to be in there. He caused too much trouble.
Right. But it was not the Haitian people who expelled him. He was absolutely loved by the common person in Haiti. Absolutely loved. They loved that man to death. You understand? And usually when you see things like that happen, you have things like religious dogma attached to it, but that wasn't the case in this case. It was almost strictly political, right? And they just found him too radical. But at the time, you know, in Haiti, especially at that time, and even to this day, you could argue, there's this extreme version of colorism that is attached to the French racial code. Half black under the French racial code is not still considered black, as in the American one-drop rule or the overall kind of English-speaking black world type of idea of blackness, you understand? And so those men, as well as the European pressures, they were the ones who essentially, and ironically, in the context of the modern bombers, kicked Joseph Robert Love out because of his radicalism. But his radicalism was not negative. His radicalism was one of liberating black people in Haiti and advocating for it. And this is also when he began, if I'm not mistaken, to write a lot.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I don't know if you could double check me on that.
I was just impressed that, again, this African man, this Bahamian man, had his own newspaper and printed.
Yes,
this before
did.
Everyone else knew.
Thank you.
But we have a caller here, and I want to patch that caller through, producer patch the caller through so they can engage us in this conversation. Go ahead, caller. Can you hear me?
A pleasant good morning, Mr. Newry. How are you doing?
I'm doing well. Go ahead.
And to your guest.
Yes, sir.
I was told that Dr. Love actually was from Chippenham.
Okay.
Attended St. Agnes Church.
Right.
Do you know that Dr. Love still has family right here in New Providence?
Oh, yes, sir. I do.
Do you know?
I've met some of them, too.
On Bar 20 Corner, there's a photography studio named Eyes of Love.
Eyes of...
Kenny Love.
All right, then. I need
Kenny
to go there.
Kenny Love and his brother Thomas Love grew up in the Valley.
All right.
Thomas Love moved to the United States. And he's still over there now, but he pops in here every so often. He used to rush through the peaks, jump in the group with the Valley Boys.
All right.
Now, Kenny Love is still here.
Okay.
Kenny Love lives up in Dan Norwich Estates. Always see Kenny Love, he always dresses in a white outfit, white tennis, white pants, white tuxedo. He's always on Bay Street taking photographs of Junkanoo.
Yes, sir. Okay.
Everybody would see Kenny Love, every Junkanoo parade go down there. Kenny Love does Junkanoo. Kenny Love was also in charge of the Photographers Association of the Bahamas.
Okay.
Kenny did a lot of photography for the Ministry of Tourism.
Right.
Kenny Love lives right here. It was Kenny Love, Thomas Love, and they had a sister. Kenny Love and Thomas Love also played dynamite soccer on the Western Fort. what we call Fort Charlotte, when they used to have baseball, softball, soccer, and cricket going on one time on Sundays. You know, on Sunday, everybody had to go to church first.
Right.
So after church, everybody would head to the Western Fort, and you would have baseball going on, all the Andre Rogers and all of them. Kenny Love, them would be on the eastern side playing soccer, and then over on Haynes, there would cricket going on.
Nice, man. Seems like they were significant back then. But yeah. Coming back to the story about Dr. Love, he's in Haiti now. He's being considered a radical. He has been expelled out of the country. Right. We go into the how he is globally significant any minute now, right?
Right.
So go ahead, tell that narrative, because we now have to go to Jamaica.
And you know what I found fascinating about that thing? I don't know when he would have learned the language. You understand? But for you to be going to another country where the language is in English and stirring people up and rallying up the crowd, you know, it's just quite, it's quite profound, you know? And it is actually the fault of us as Bahamians why he is not on the pedestal that he should be on. Number one, as we always discuss, and I've heard you say it many, many times, we only focusing on a certain period of our history.
Mm-hmm.
And even within that certain period, you know, we only focusing on specific groups of people. And that's why when you look at our pantheon of national heroes and national honors, let's be honest, you know, it's quite demoralizing. And it's only pastors, politicians, for the most part.
I'm not sure if even have our politicians is aware of who Robert Love is, right?
Yeah.
Even though he's a global significant figure,
right,
where the world celebrates him as being one of the smartest black men, we have yet to claim him and own him and celebrate him as one of the forces that the Bahamas should be proud of. Because Jamaica have even Edward Sharpe, the slave runaway. We have whole Love.
Right.
And anyway, now he's in Jamaica.
And on the comment of the call now, that was some pretty, pretty interesting information. And I think everybody appreciated it. But my research showed that he was born in the Bain and Grantstown area.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why I'd like to meet with members of the family and see if we could pinpoint that house even, you know. Mm-hmm. I think that would be something very interesting in that house, if it's still indeed standing, which is very possible. We need to, or at least to find, we need to do something commemorating him, man, you know. And for Joseph Robert Love too, you know, and I hate to say it like this, he is a palatable hero for the world, you know. So we have people like Dick DeVoe. Dick DeVoe fire shots at a slave master. We got people like Abraham, Neptune, and Monday Pratt, who murdered their very, very cruel overseer. You understand? These people who lose their life and committed the most courageous acts when most Bahamians were at their absolute lowest, which was being chattel slaves. Those are our predominant national heroes, and those that fought oppression. You see, and Joseph Robert Love represents something where we need to realize that we need to stop being scared to talk about how we fight against slavery. We need to stop being scared against how we fight it. We love to talk about the Burma Road uprising, Manchester United, Lewis, and then the English people from Manchester break up a couple of cars because they mad at T.M. Lewis. But an uprising is a result of decades, sometimes even centuries of oppression within that same area that just been bubbling up for time. And then you have that straw, that proverbial straw that breaks the camel's back. So we have to stop being ashamed to claim people like this, because these are not just our heroes. These are heroes of the African diaspora.
Robert Love was also a politician.
Yep.
He was a politician in Jamaica. He's a politician in Haiti also. Right?
Yep.
And caused chaos down there.
Right.
Right? But he also influenced people. He turned to a movement.
Right.
Where, like you said, deified, we haven't deified him here.
Right.
But he is deified in the Caribbean.
Yeah, he is.
Give me an example of someone who holds Robert Love in that esteem, would start a movement. I may know the answer, but I want you to know.
Well, pretty much every top Pan-African scholar that I've had the pleasure to speak to, you know, people like Kimani Nuhusi, originally from Guyana, he was he knew fully of Joseph Robert Love when I met him over the phone years ago. You know, and he's Joseph Robert Love, I believe, speaking about. And I think that was the only Bahamian he really knew anything about. Dr. Umar Johnson also knows him very much, and he speaks extensively on him as well. You could look at it on YouTube, man, and see who making the documentaries. Many of the documentaries coming out of Jamaica because of his relationship with Marcus Garvey that we can get into
I want to read this point, right? Mm-hmm. Well, while he's in Jamaica, right, he led the first black voters registration.
There you go.
To have black people vote.
All right.
Right?
In Jamaica.
And in Jamaica. And the white elite in the colony of Jamaica was worried that Dr. Love was filling the heads of black people with dangerous ideas of radical equality.
Mm-hmm. Man, he's radical equality.
He's one of the first black doctors in the world, by the way.
Right.
So you know, I appreciate that,
right? Yeah, right.
Say, a politician in Jamaica, John Vassal Calder, claimed that black people lack the mental capacity to thrive, and he stated that Dr. Love must remember that his ancestors were my ancestors' slaves. He could never be my equal. And the idea that you are here in Jamaica trying to make black people equal will never happen. This was said about Dr. Love.
You hear that, right? He is a Bahamian. Mm-hmm. He is a Bahamian. You know?
Uh-huh.
You see that feeling, you get anger, and you was just like, better things, I would tell that man, and that just in the back of your mind. I know it in the back of your mind. Mm-hmm. It's in the back of my mind. That's Joseph Robert Love, and, you know, and I was love to be like a fly on the wall in a room like that, you know, and just hear his unfiltered responses
mm-hmm.
before he composed himself and so graciously and effectively put them in their place in a time where it was so difficult and delicate to do so, you know. But at the end of the day, despite the way that he was so cleverly able to navigate the system that he was in, because that's what we need to remember now, you know. So look, though
they came close to killing him a couple of times.
Right, exactly. There were many attempts on his life. And people like that, that is what they actually face, you see. We sometimes, as Africans, as black people, we lose sight of what our ancestors did to bring us here.
Mm-hmm.
Even though we still get many rivers to cross, as so they say, right?
Mm-hmm.
We lose sight of that, man. This is across the board. There's another man to segue away from him for a minute. Named James Carmichael Smith, no relation to the governor, though he was named after him.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this is another very interesting character who we could learn a lot from. He was born in Kidd Island, happy to say. Shout out to my people in Kidd Island, especially the ones in and around Old Bight.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Browntown, Davis, Dawkins, you all know what's going on.
Mm-hmm.
Now, and then, right back. All right, so he was born in Kidd Island. His mother was a Haitian, and his father was a white man from somewhere in Britain, I believe it was Yorkshire.
Why is so much Haitian in our history, man?
Right, yeah, you know, right? Right. So he became another one, even though he was a quote-unquote mulatto. See, now, he was functioning in this Bahamas space too, spent his entire childhood here, radicalized here. You see, and this is what is important too. So it isn't like these fellas, as many times happening, I'm not saying it's a good or a bad thing or saying anyone better or worse because of it. But oftentimes, those of our people who are very high influence, they tend to leave very early. You know, they might have been born here. You know, Sydney Poitier is a good example, mm-hmm. right? They tend to leave very early. But these are men who spent considerable time in the Bahamas. He attempted to publish a newspaper here. I believe it was called The Liberator.
Mm-hmm.
And I also believe that he was heavily influenced by Joseph Robert Love as well, right? Now, even if he didn't have a direct influence, he most certainly would have been, you know, because those who would have had that fire in their belly, that black pride, even in the space of all that oppression and indoctrination, they would have definitely known who Joseph Robert Love was. Mm-hmm. You understand? The same way how Wild Marge Monroe is, right? Everyone knows who Marge Monroe was.
He's a global entity.
There are people he's never met who he has influenced.
Mm-hmm.
People who never meet the man, never lay eyes on the man, who cried when they heard what happened. Mm-hmm. You understand? So, and this is the type of influence that Joseph Robert Love had, right? Now, but getting radical, you're publishing your newspaper. Smith had a relationship with Stephen Dillett's granddaughter. And Stephen Dillett Sr., not Jr., is the one I think we really need to take a close look at. Because, you know, they find a picture of him, right? You see the picture?
And let me put this point.
All right, then.
The school, Stephen Dillett School, is not named after the first man of color of the Bahamas. The school is not named after the first colored man.
No.
However, it's named after his son.
Stephen Dillett, and who was a school teacher.
And for me, he is more of a national hero because there's just too much difficult things. Now, at the end of the day, Stephen Dillett Sr. might just slide in there because, of course, of the significance of his position and his ethnicity. Even though when you look at the picture of him and you think of what a conky Joe is today, he was passing for white all day. But that's for another argument, you know, former slave owner, all of these things, right? So he was a man of that French racial code. And the only reason they used to do him so bad was because he was from Haiti, and they knew that his mother was a woman of color. You understand? Now, let's get back to the man of the hour, Joseph Robert Love, right? So now he's in Jamaica. You got young Marcus Garvey attending school, learning after this man. Forward a little bit, we know when Marcus Garvey, when Joseph Robert Love passed away, you know that that was the cause of the founding of the UNIA?
Go ahead, tell me.
If you had to say it was one thing.
And say the acronym UNIA is because people universal.
Okay, right. The Universal Negro Improvement Association. This is the most organized, the most well-followed, the most influential black organization that has ever existed in history. And as a matter of fact, it still exists. It still exists, right? But when you say, a lot of people say existed, because that is how profound this organization was. And over time, us as African people has lost sight of the proverbial mission, because freedom for us now is just acceptance in the Western society. You know, freedom for us is not regaining our culture, living the way that Africans do again, and being African again. I know I'm making people cringe right now, even by saying being African again and doing that, you know. But you know, it's the sad reality of our existence. And this was someone, you know, despite all of his academic genius with Joseph Robert Love, for me, his true genius was his political genius. You know, he developed concepts and outlooks that were completely unprecedented. You understand? While when you have to understand this in the decades after child slavery ended, when we are, you know, almost at our lowest, completely dejected. And he was able to use what he did in Jamaica in allowing blacks to be able to vote. And not only did he allow blacks to be able to vote, he told blacks to vote based on your blackness. Mm-hmm. And especially in the context of the 1870s now, eh? Or so. You know, that was extremely important. Mm-hmm. And it still is just as important to this day. But back then, you can't argue if that was important or not. You understand? Right.
So Robert Love basically started the, again, the Pan-African movement, because he influenced Marcus Garvey.
Right.
And we all know Marcus Garvey, and we need to throw in two Bahamian names who influenced Marcus Garvey besides Robert Love. And then by extension, Malcolm X, and by extension, the whole black movement in the United States, all started because of a black Bahamian. Yeah. And his legacy and his teachings and his writings started basically the black movement, or what do you call it? Equality, what do you call it? Civil rights movement.
All of these concepts can be accredited to men like Joseph Robert Love, because these are concepts that existed within the oppressive system. I think that for me, that was what he did. Because remember, we always resisted now. You know, there were people who we could identify as Pan-Africanists long before even Martin Delaney. Mm-hmm. I think even that is something that we have to rethink. Those Maroon leaders who are more receptive of other Africans can be seen as Pan-Africanists. Mm-hmm. John Canoe I, our hero, was definitely a Pan-Africanist. He had 15,000 troops minimum, and most of them wasn't even from his tribe. Mm. So I think that speaks to it enough. He saw, okay, this seems to be African versus everybody else type of thing. You understand?
And let's segue a bit. Is there still room for Pan-Africanism in the Bahamas? Because, you know, we are a diverse society. Mm-hmm. And we accept our colonial past, our slavery past. Mm-hmm. But surely we should move away from this black-white thing and move as just Bahamians. Mm-hmm. Or is there still a need to be black and proud?
Oh, yeah. There's definitely a need to be black and proud. People have to understand how entrenched the negative and demonization of African culture, African people has been, where that everything synonymous with black or African is automatically negative. Coming from our perspective, that is not the perspective It is a little bit in Africa, but it's not as widespread as it is in the West, space, at least in my opinion, right? And there's definitely space for it. People try to dismiss it as something that is impractical, something that is archaic, but it certainly isn't. Remember, it means all Africans, and Pan-Africanism has evolved with the times, and they even have new names, new monikers, Afrofuturism, you know, all sorts of different terms, African internationalists, you know, and people moving away from the term Pan-Africanist because everyone who calls this that, you know, but for me, Pan-Africanist is the broadest term and the most inclusive one. This includes anybody who politically is doing well on behalf of African people. And it is certainly needed because we don't understand the thing, but I think we got to go to a break.
So yeah, we're going to break the music.
Pick up on that afterwards.
I'm speaking to Christopher Davis, John Canoe II. We're talking about loosely about Pan-Africanism. We're talking more about Dr. Joseph Robert Love, who is a global figure. Mm-hmm. And we're trying to say, why isn't he being celebrated in the Bahamas? Mm-hmm. Because he's considered one of the smartest black men ever in the history of the world. And we need to recognize him and claim him and proclaim him inside the world and say, no, he Bahamian. Oh, he's one of us.
Big time.
So we'll be right back.
Yeah, you know.
The new Guardian Radio app is here. Listen live to all our Guardian Radio shows and live video stream select programs in our studio. Get information about Guardian Radio shows and our hosts. Send messages, including text, email, and even call. All from our amazing new Guardian Radio app. Download it in your App Store for your Apple device or Play Store for your Android device. The all-new and improved Guardian Radio app.
Love the show? Want to give your support? Become a sponsor today. Call 302-2300-PACKAGES. That's 302-2300. Become a sponsor on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
Always on the go? Missed the show? You can now listen to Guardian Radio talk shows anytime, anywhere on Spotify and YouTube by searching Guardian Radio 96.9 FM or by entering the name of your favorite show. You can also listen by logging on to guardiantalkradio.com and clicking on the podcast tab. Guardian Radio, continuing to provide you with fresh news and smart talk anywhere, anytime, all day.
This is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
And welcome back to Guardian Radio AM. We're talking to the genius, the Bahamian genius. In lack of better terms, if modern day, he would be considered a Rhodes Scholar. Mm-hmm. That's how brilliant he was. Who became one of the first black doctors in this hemisphere, who became one of the first rectors, who led political movements until he was expelled from Haiti for his radicalism, gone in Jamaica where they said, man, this boy gotta go. Mm-hmm. He's leading too much. Started the whole equality registration, voters registration inside Jamaica. A Bahamian did this, right?
Yep.
Who started an entire movement in terms of inspiring Marcus Garvey to say Marcus and Garveyism, where they tout him as being the inspiration for Marcus Garvey Garveyism, mm-hmm. and who again inspired the entire civil rights movement in the United States. All that stem from a Bahamian,
right?
And we're saying that this Bahamian, especially as we celebrate our 50th Independence Day celebration, is some persons that we need to herald and say that we had Bahamians and black Bahamians, mm-hmm. a black Bahamian,
yeah.
way back then at a genius level.
Mm-hmm.
Who inspired the world, who is globally significant.
Yep.
Globally significant as a Miles Monroe.
Yep.
Globally significant as a Sidney Poitier.
Mm-hmm.
Globally significant, what the next actor yep. name? The one who do the blackface. Mm-hmm. Name just gone.
Oh, Bert Williams. Yeah,
then there's
Bert
Calvin Williams. Lockhart.
Calvin Lockhart. Right.
Globally significant. This Dr. Love is, mind you, he's beyond all those names I call. Also, the Miles Monroe in terms of globally significant.
I mean, truthfully, yes. Yeah.
We're not diminishing Miles Monroe, because we know Miles Monroe is an icon. Sidney Poitier is an icon.
Miles Monroe is a religious leader.
Yes, and Sidney Poitier is an actor. But
He had global political influence and changed the world forever for African people for a positive way. We took a giant leap or a small step, or however you look at it, but we definitely made progress. Even if it's only in Jamaica, you understand, and in the United States. And then, but then when, again, when we look at his influence on people like Marcus Garvey, right? And then Marcus Garvey influenced who? Kwame Nkrumah. And who was Kwame Nkrumah? He is the first president of the first independent black nation in the 20th century that sparked everyone getting their independence, including the Bahamas. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. You know who else was mixed up in that? C.R. Walker, Mabel Walker, the Harlem Renaissance.
You see? C.R. Walker was.
That's another one, but we must do another show on him. But I really love Mabel. She wasn't born here, but of course, she's a Bahamian. Mm-hmm. You understand? Back to let's call him Uncle Joseph, right? Back to Uncle Joseph. Yeah, man, he's just amazing and just a profound figure, you know. And there are people here too that truly do commemorate him. I know through Lewis Street, I believe, if I'm not mistaken, there's some small commemoration of him in some artwork. Of course, people like the incoming ambassador, Andrew Wilson, sponsored the bus that was at UB for a while, and they had a whole thing that was years ago though. But he needs to be, and I hope that the people planning the our celebrations are listening in. You know, you can hit me up if you all need me to, you know, add a few more cultural quirks and Pan-Africanist quirks and some of our real Bahamian heroes that actually fought for us, because I think it would be a cardinal sin if this is too seen as a partisan thing, or even seeing it as something that is too 20th century centric.
And yeah. I'll stop you there, because I want to know your opinion on it.
Right.
And I know we're running out of time, so that's why let me stop you there, because we're still celebrating Dr. Love, Dr. Joseph Robert Love, mm-hmm. and his global significance,
right.
And his significance should be celebrated here locally, mm-hmm. right? Being one of the first black doctors in this part of the hemisphere, being one of the first black clergymen, rectors of a whole Anglican church in this hemisphere, being one of the first black politicians in this hemisphere, right?
Medical doctor. Journalist.
Publisher. The audacity when the people are not supposed to be able to read and write, he did all of this, right?
Right.
Would you support a garden of remembrance of globally significant Caribbean figures? And not just like Robert Love, I know he's Bahamian, right? He should be celebrating our Boston explanation of who he is.
Yeah.
So persons who are doing the Mecca.
Right.
Well, I know. How is it that Robert Love is Bahamian and we know him as being part of us?
Right.
Or persons like a Sidney Poitier, and they say, how is Sidney Poitier connected to the Bahamas and we know him as being a part of us? Of course, Lyndon and what is the persons who did the United
We can get on them too. So
we're running out of time. We got to do all that.
Sorry. All right. But
go ahead.
There were very globally significant Bahamian Pan-Africanists, right? And just to breeze through a few other ones, you have Edwin Pratt, Father Josephus Pratt, born in Kidd Island again. Don't mind my Kidd Island bias. I can move the other ones. He became what they call the Martin Luther King. Did pretty much what Martin Luther King did nationally, but in his little corner in the northwestern United States. You have Alexander Ramming, who was the founder and first president of the Harlem chapter of the United Negro Improvement Association, also known as the UNIA, one of Marcus Garvey's right-hand men who fell on his sword with Marcus Garvey. But we like to focus on Joshua Cockburn.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And even
Cockburn Street, right down the road there.
Right, you know? So not only do we need that park, we need to rename these schools. We still get schools named Albury Sale, mm-hmm. after the so-called Lutheran Adventurers, who was just a bunch of Puritan. In the British Civil War, they never mentioned the English Civil War. Mm-hmm. When they're talking about it, that's what was happening. That's what the beef was.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't no big thing, but, we don't have free... Pure foolishness. Mm-hmm. They were Puritans, mm-hmm. and undesirables, most half of whom were almost people of African descent like us. And by the way, they sent their undesirable, quote-unquote, Negroes to the Bahamas, right? And then you have, of course, who we mentioned earlier, James Carmichael Smith, no relation to the governor, but named in commemoration of the governor, Joseph Robert Love. You get Albert Forsyth. He taught the Tuskegee Airmen. You know, we could go on and on.
We have both globally significant people like that.
And not just globally significant. These Pan-Africanists who improve the situation for blacks, even though I have a problem with people of African descent fighting the wars of the Western world, but that's for another day. But at the same time, it's something that is commemorable because we know what those Tuskegee Airmen did. They, in my opinion, you know, those fascists were definitely the greater of two evils. Eh? You know?
We can have a museum just for these globally speaking people.
Right,
attraction.
One just for actors.
Yeah.
You know, we are tourism. People come from museums. You do them in the museums and the areas that they come from. It's not rocket science. But they ain't gonna put me on, your CCA. They ain't gonna put people like me in one, man. But we can talk about that off air.
I could even picture a museum just on Bohemian actors. Have Sidney Poitier, Calvin Lockhart. What the next one is?
Burt Williams, first black man on Broadway, the first black man on screen, the first black man to kiss a woman on screen, five-time best recording selling artist. The man was a songbird as well, and he used to get beat up after every show. He was an alcoholic, and racism caused him to pretty much drink himself to death.
Imagine a museum just on them? But anyway, the music. Yeah, the music playing, and I understand. But we have so much things to set out off.
Oh, yeah.
And I just want to remind people that Dr. Joseph Robert Love is Bohemian. He's globally significant, and we need to celebrate him.
So,
anyway, we ran out of time. Have a wonderful day. This has been Guardian Radio AM, and thank you very much for Christopher David.
Thank you, brother.